hand clap of praise. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Good evening. Happy Wednesday. Aren't y'all excited to be here? I love Wednesday. So excited to be here. So I get to do your announcements again. Sorry. Okay, right now I want y'all to remember to be praying for Miss Robin. She's in Haiti. So we want to remember her. We are so glad that Love's Way was able to send $2,100 to the orphanage in Haiti. That is awesome. Thank you very much. This Thursday, tomorrow, is the giveaway at Joseph's Storehouse, and also this Saturday. And Mr. Robert says he wants you there at 8:30. Be prompt, please. Prayer starts at 8:45. We are starting a Love's Way 101 class that will begin Sunday, April the 2nd. It'll be from 9 to 9:50 in the Fellowship Hall. That is for new Christians as well as mature Christians. It's going to be answering commonly asked questions about the Christian faith and misconceptions about God and the Bible. If you want to sign up for that, space is limited, but there's a sign-up sheet out at the welcome desk if you would sign up for that. Y'all, please excuse me. The devil tried to attack me when I was worshiping the Lord. He does this often. He did this to me Sunday. So I refuse to be defeated. In the name of Jesus, thank you. Excuse me, I'm so sorry. Also, next week after the service, after the Sunday service, there will be a financial meeting here in the sanctuary. That will be held by Miss Chris Johnson, and it will be briefing on the 2016 financials. So you're welcome to attend that. Monday, March 27th is going to be our ladies' fellowship at 6:30 p.m. Please come. We have a great time. We'd love to meet you if you've not been. Also, on Tuesday, April the 11th at 6:30 is Men of Valor, and I'm sure the men would love to meet you. We will be doing Good Friday, April the 14th. Of course, it's Friday. At 5:30, we will meet at City Square, and we will do Walk of the Cross from City Square all the way to City Hall. So we'd love to have you join us for that. Just kind of make it a family affair. That would be great. And then rest up on Saturday. I keep telling you this because it's a busy, busy weekend. Sunday, April the 16th, is Easter. I'm so excited. I love Easter. Not because of the bunny. I love to celebrate Jesus any day of the year. At 6 a.m., we will be doing a sunrise service and breakfast. The men will be serving breakfast. You don't want to miss that. Maybe they'll clean up too. That would be great. And then at 10 a.m., we will have the Easter celebration service. So we'd love to see you here for that. And please make sure your kiddos are here, because from ages 1 through 12, we are doing an indoor egg hunt down in the fellowship hall. You will not want to miss this. It's going to be exciting. And I know that because I'm helping. It's going to be great. All right. I think that's all that I have. With the ushers, please come for the offering. Yes. Woo-woo! Offering! I wanted to use the sparkles we had left over from Brandon's wedding, but that kind of got nixed. I wasn't allowed to do that. So, Steve, would you pray for the offering tonight, please?
Well, Father, Lord, we're just humbled in your presence. It's just amazing, Lord, to be able to draw near to the creator of the universe. We worship you tonight, Lord. There's nothing else we'd rather do than to sit at your feet. So we just give you praise and thanks. Thank you for your blessings on this offering and all who give. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Can I use your mic?
I'll pass it back to you later.
Praise the Lord. I was glad when they said unto us, let us go to the house of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I feel the Holy Spirit this evening, but I've been feeling him for about a month. I was telling the people in the back, so he is good. How many of y'all feel the presence of the Lord? Yeah. Amen. I've asked, sorry about that. Going to get centered here. So for those symmetrical people that need it symmetrical, we'll do that. I've been asking people this question, and just be honest, there's no right or wrong answer. Don't feel pressured to say, yes, I feel that way. But how many of y'all been feeling the pulling of the Holy Spirit to go deeper and further? How many of y'all been feeling that? I've been feeling it big time. And I'll answer it and say, yes, Lord. Amen? He is good. Pastor is headed to, is in Virginia. Pastor and sister pastor. They are in Virginia with Raymond. He had some knee surgery today, and they want to take care of him. You know, Mama loves her little baby boy, so she was like, we are going. And Pastor called me, I was over at his house when he made the decision, and he was like, can you speak? And I said, sure. But if I drop this mic, I know that there's so many people that could pick it up and minister. So many people in this room, and I'm honored to be able to speak to you and just share what God has put on my heart. And thank you. Amen. If you have your Bible, you can turn with me to Matthew chapter 22, verse 34, and also going to go to Psalms chapter 1. But just before we do that, there's a song on my heart, and I don't know if you know it, and it doesn't really matter if you know it or not. I just want you to receive this for a minute, and just close your eyes and just receive, okay? I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, I feel it coming alive. Help me find my own flame. Help me find my own fire. I want your burning desire. Oh, yes, I do. I don't want to ride on somebody else's passion. I don't want to find that I'm just dry bones. I want to burn with unquenchable fire. Deep down inside, help me come it alive. Help me find my own flame. I want the real thing. I want your burning desire. Come and do what you do. Come and do what you do. In my heart, come and do what you do. There's no better time. There's no better time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are doing Friday night intense prayer nights. I want to invite you to that. It's not this Friday, but next Friday, I want to invite you to come out to the... We're not sitting around a desk and taking turns to pray or anything. We're turning on music loud, and the reason I like to put it loud is because I like to just pray out loud and just scream, and I don't want other people to hear what I'm saying. I just want to press in, and it has been good. Last Friday, I was really pushing, and I was like, God, just let me feel your glory. I want to feel your glory. And, man, I didn't feel anything, but God is still good, right? And so I don't want to be feeling, go by feeling. So I was like, whatever, God, you're still good. I'm still going to press in. And then we did at the prayer meeting, what did we call it? The glory seat. And we just prayed over each other. And when they prayed for me, I could barely, I could not get off the chair for the longest time. And when I finally did, my legs were so weak that I just leaned up on the stage. I mean, it is good stuff. Y'all, so if you can make it 2 weeks Friday, not this Friday, but next Friday. Y'all there in Matthew chapter 22, verse 34? Are y'all this quiet every Wednesday night, or is it just because I'm here? Matthew chapter 22, verse 34. I guess I should get there too. Yeah. It said, hearing that, Jesus had, where are we at? I want to actually jump down here to 35. One of them, an expert of the law, tested him with a question and said, teacher, which is the greatest command in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And then 39 says, and the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. And all the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. So I was praying, I would say maybe last week sometime, and the Holy Spirit took me to Psalms chapter 1. And then Miss Karen prophesied over me this exact scripture. It was just that boom confirmation. You know what I'm talking about? Y'all love the boom confirmation? It says, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked or stand in the way of the sinners, take or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your kingdom. I pray that your kingdom come in this room as it is in heaven. Fill us up with your presence. Fill us up with your glory. In Jesus' powerful name, speak to us. Amen. So I was like, I guess God's capturing my attention, so I wanted to meditate and study the law. There are 613 laws for us to study. How many of y'all got time for that? So then I was like, is there an easier way? And Jesus said, yeah, there's two that sum up all. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your body, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And I was like, sweet. Thank you for simplifying. It's good stuff, right? So Jesus fulfilled the law, and so now the law has been fulfilled. So we don't have to walk in condemnation if you don't fulfill every part of it, because his blood on the cross has made us righteous. Everybody with me? I'm just going to talk really quick. I promise I'll let you out in like 15 minutes if you'll be with me for 15 minutes, okay? 15, 20 minutes. I'm going to be done with my part. The Holy Spirit, he can do whatever he wants to do after that. So through Jesus Christ, he has fulfilled the law, so therefore now I am under grace, amen? So there's a twisted grace that's been going around, or a false grace, if you want to call it, that we can do whatever we want to and make it to heaven because his grace covers us. Well, turn to Romans chapter 6, verse 1. Romans 6, verse 1. I was just going to tell it to you, but it's good to read these things because it'll get in your heart. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Come on now. Help me out. Or do you not know that all of us were baptized with Christ, were baptized unto his death? We were therefore buried with him through the baptism into death, or under that. And we'll stop there. But basically, God's grace is amazing. Yes. He wants us to walk in the law, right? So the law. And then Jesus paid the price so that we are now righteous. So yeah, we can do whatever we want. No, we still walk in obedience. I'm going to get somewhere, I promise you. You're like, what's he doing? I've got an ending destination. It's on page 20. So in righteousness of grace, Jesus has fulfilled the law, and he summed it up and said, "Love God with all of you, and love your neighbors yourself." So we are now obedient driven rather than condemnation or law driven or fear of going to hell driven. Is everybody with me? So you love God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your body. And so you are obedient driven now. So you're not trying to fulfill a bunch of religious duties. You're just hearing God and being obedient to what he has for you. Come on now. This is good stuff. I'm gonna have to come over here to these passionate people over here. So we're not duty drawn or driven. We're not driven by the fear of going to hell. We're not driven by the fear of, I've got to accomplish 613 laws. I'm now hearing the word of God and responding to him because I love him. Because he is amazing. It is the greatest command to love him. To love him with everything inside of us. Even Jesus did not move without hearing the Father. So we like, yeah, make big life decisions without praying. Go for it. Jesus didn't even move without hearing the Father's voice. Did Jesus have permission? Okay, we're talking about the Son of God. The Son of God can do whatever he wants. But he was reflecting the Father's heart because he loved the Father. Therefore, he was obedient to the Father. Amen? Hopefully, this frees you a little bit tonight. It freed me. And so I'm not afraid of the punishment, and I'm not driven by the fact that I want to keep, I'm driven by the fact that I want to keep him near me. Bill Johnson said the Holy Spirit is like carrying a dove on your shoulder. And so if I've got the dove on my shoulder, how do I get to that point without scaring the dove and letting it fly off? Very carefully. I step. I hear him. That's the wrong one. I'm moving this way. No, that's not that. Don't do that. Holy Spirit driven, love driven, forced by his words because I'm in love with him and I don't want him to move. I remember when the Holy Spirit hit me the most powerful way that I've ever felt him at the Brownsville Revival. And I don't mean to annoy anyone by talking about it so much, but it was awesome. But I can remember just even getting into my car, and I wasn't listening to like secular or worldly music. I think it was K-Love or something like that. But I was feeling the heavy weight of his presence so strong on my when I started the car, and I just heard that music. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Like, it was like I had to turn it down because I don't want to scare the dove off of me. And I want to walk in his presence. I want to walk where he is. I want to walk what he's, if he's over here, that's where I want to go. How many times have we felt him and then grieved him and he went away? And it's not even big sin stuff. You know what I'm talking? Christian radio is not sin stuff. But in that moment when he's moving on you, what are you feeling? What are you doing? So then the Bible says, love God and love your neighbor. So when we encounter somebody that says, hey, brother, how many of y'all, does anybody go to work in here? Let me take a sip of this, if you don't mind. I am just. That gentleman scared the lady there. Congratulations. So, If you're at work and someone's like, hey, man, I'm just going through a rough time. Can you pray? Just remember me in your prayers. Yeah, I'll definitely remember in your prayers. How many of y'all ever done this, okay? Man, you know, so-and-so, I'm dealing with some stomach stuff. I got cancer or whatever it is, and just say a prayer for me. Sure, I'll pray for you. And then you go home and if you remember, you say your prayer. Come on, anybody do this? I'll remember you in my prayers. I'll remember you in my thoughts. But now we love God, and we're so in tune with God that we also love people like we love ourselves. And now we're not just, yeah, I'll remember to pray for you. Now you're compassion-driven, and it's true love. And so you can't wait to pray for them tomorrow or when you get home or in your private place. You walk right up to them right then and say, here you go. I know you said wait, but right here, in the name of Jesus, be healed. And not have fear that it won't happen because you know that Jesus Christ has paid the price. And he said, it is finished. And not only did he say it is finished, but now you know the God, the creator, because you're listening to his voice and now you're compassion driven. And you know it will happen. I feel the Holy Spirit. So I'm sick of, or I'm not sick at all, I'm healthy. But we've watered down the gospel so much. We are nowhere near normal. Normal is about 10 notches higher than what we are. And I'm talking about me. I'm talking about us. See, normal is walking around and feeling that someone is depressed and going right up to them and speaking life. See, normal, oh, wow. See, Christianity is following Christ. Is everybody with me? If you are a Christian, you are a follower of Christ. So it's not, and you know how they keep politics and stuff and Christianity at home. And no, Christianity isn't something that I can take off after Sunday morning. Christianity is who I am all the time. It's not a badge of honor. It's not something I put on the shelf. It's who I am all the time. And so if I'm a police officer, I first am a Christ follower. And so when I pull someone over and I bump into them and immediately I feel that they need prayer, I'm not worried about the job that I've got. I'm worried about the king that I would upset if I did not serve. You're not supposed to do that in a government job. I don't care. I'm Christ follower first. Trust me, if I get fired over something like that, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And so we are, whoever you encounter, well, God, just let me encounter somebody today. No! You encounter people all the time. Very the person that you're supposed to encounter. I'm going to go to the mall today. Boop, 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 boop. There's a person. Hey, Jesus loves you. Why? Because you're compassion-driven, because you love people like you love yourself. You love God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your soul. See, we do the WWJD bracelet. How many of y'all remember that when it came out? WWJD, it's on the t-shirts. It's everywhere you go. WWJD bracelets. But we keep that as a moral dilemma problem. Would Jesus go to that store? No. Would Jesus watch that movie? No, he would never watch that movie. I'm not going to watch that movie. My bracelet says. But what would Jesus do if he encountered someone with cancer? What would Jesus have done if he encountered somebody that was lame and blind? What would Jesus have done if he encountered somebody that was depressed? What would Jesus have done if he encountered somebody that needed to get to heaven, they're on the way to hell? What would Jesus do then? So bring the bracelet back. Come on now. I've come across, in my profession, dead people. Yep. And the first thought in my mind every time is, I'm going to raise them up. And the last gentleman that had passed away, I walked over to him, and I put my hand on his head, and I said, in the name of Jesus, wake up right now, in the name of Jesus. And he wouldn't do it, so I squeezed his head as hard as I could, and I said, did you hear me? Death, let go of your grip in the name of Jesus. Raise up right now. Nothing happened. Yep. So here's the two thoughts that could happen. God, where were you? Unanswered prayers there all the time. Where were you? Or, Andrew, what do you need to do to have more authority even over death? So what we do is we try to blame God. See, he's in control of everything, right? So this is what the devil does. He's like, hey, demons, come around. Let's think of the best way. And this is his biggest plan, his biggest trick. God's in control of everything. And he whispers, God's in control of everything. Why did he let that happen? No, the devil came to kill, steal, and destroy. God, every good and perfect gift comes from him. It was not his will that anyone should perish. He paid the price on Calvary so that we could be healed, so that we could be set free, so we could be delivered. He paid that price, and he said, it is finished. It is not his fault. Amen? So the devil says, hey, look. How many of y'all know that some of the devil's tricks and plans are super obvious? I'll tell you what, we had some amazing meetings. How many of y'all know that a message like this, the devil will attack you? Because the first thing you're going to do is like, maybe I do need to get a little bit more on fire. And the next thing that's going to happen is the devil's going to attack you because he hates the truth. He hates this stuff. And so we would have great meetings. And then immediately my transmission would go out the next day, and I'd be like, you think that's going to fool me, devil? I know it's you. I know it's you. So, ha, 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 hallelujah, praise you, Jesus, glory to God, you're worthy. You know what I'm saying? Some of them are just obvious. You're like, you're an idiot. So we fix the transmission. The next day after the transmission's fixed, the drive shaft is breaking off. And it's a good truck. It was a GMC. So it's obvious that the devil is attacking this. It's obvious. And so I laugh at all. You're dumb. But he also does those tricks where, man, listen, if you're in tune with God, you're going to find out that everything he does is a trick, and you'll find it quicker. Yeah? So he says, hey, look at No, man, let's look inward, find out what we need to do. So when I was praying that, I was asking the Lord, what hinders me or stops me from being powerful? The first thing that I could think of was there's hooks. How many of y'all know that whatever environment that you go into, that there may be a trace of something that has attached itself, or hooks, whatever you've let in, there's hooks. Pastor used the open door Sunday. You open the door and then you left just a crack, but he was able to sneak in. There's also hooks that you've allowed the devil to just to pull on, and it's time to remove the hooks. Amen? Just take them off. Just shut the door. Don't let him have any path in. Let him have no foothold. So the second issue that I felt like I had was to be more story-driven than compassion-driven. And that's back to the heart issue. Does anyone know what I'm saying? Story-driven? Yeah, dude, you should have seen it. I prayed for that dead guy, and he raised up. Woo! I got a cool story now. But it's the heart issue is that, no, man, that guy may be in hell right now, and I need to rescue him and raise him up. That's the compassion. That's the heart issue again. And so I remember when Steve Hill would preach at the Browns Revival, and he would cry as he called for sinners to come forward. And it wasn't a put-on thing where look at that guy, he's crying. No, man, this guy loved people, and he could see them falling into hell and would call them back with tears in his eyes. Compassion-driven, love-driven. Is everybody with me? Almost done. Look at this. Just 10 more pages to go. So I looked at myself and I said, there's three things that I could get rid of and just be powerful. I'd be an amazing man of God. So I dumped those three things and here we go. We're going after God. It's going to be amazing. But the craziest thing is that the closer that I get to God, the more things pop up. You know what I'm saying? And it's not condemnation. I'm not like, see, I'm forgiven. I'm washed in the blood. I don't have to, the past has nothing on, it doesn't pull me. It doesn't hold me. It's against the word of God if it's pulling you and condemning you. No, you've been forgiven. And that word that I used a minute ago, it is finished. So you've been forgiven. But the closer that you get to God, the more he requires of you. And it's not a burden to me. It's not like condemnation. It's more like, wow, you are so worth this. This is amazing. I'm willing to do, yeah, I'll give up that. I didn't even know there was an issue. I'll give up that too. What else do I need to give up? Because, wow, if this is you and this is how I'm feeling, this is what you're doing, you're amazing. Come on. So it's not a condemnation thing. It's I love him so much that all my soul, all my mind, and I love him. So now I'm voice driven. I'm voice driven. There's no fear of anything else. I'm just driven by his voice. What does God want me to do? Where does God want me? What does God want me to leave behind? What does God want me? Where does he want me to step? Where does he want me to go? What does he want me to do? Voice driven. Man, when I wrote that word down, voice driven, it just was like, God's voice driven. God's voice driven. Knowing God on such a level that every single move that you make is his voice. It's his voice and you can hear him. His voice and you know where to step. You know his will. Because you are in tune like Jesus was in tune. I'm wrapping it up, I promise. I see some people going. So today I was working with my little brother, Brandon. And I asked him 1, 2, 3, 4 questions. And I'll ask them rhetorically because I know there's a lot of people in here that if we all answered, it would take a lot of time. So just think about these things as I ask them. And don't answer quickly in your mind. Think about them. Why do you need to know God? Why do I need to know God? And I'm not talking about salvation. That's the obvious. Because I want to be saved. No, I'm not talking about salvation. Why do you need to know him like Abraham knew him? Why do you need to know him like Moses knew him? So Brandon answered. He took some thought to think about it, and he said, because I want to know his voice, I want to know his will. And then I was pushing him a little bit further, and he said, I want to have him with me so that when I do run into someone that I can operate in his power and his demonstration. And I was like, okay, give me some more. And he said, remember when you were talking, there was a young guy in my youth group. His name was Brett. And I'd met him at Sonic. And some of his friends came over to where we were eating. And one of them was an atheist. And Brett was like, I was talking to him about Christ and inviting them to the church. And he's like, oh, he won't come. He's an atheist. So I told the atheist, listen, dude, I know you don't believe in him. I was the same way. But I want to tell you this, that I know he's real. And it's not about head knowledge. It's I know he's real. And I want you to go home tonight, and I want you to say this, God, if you are real, let me feel your presence. And when I said that, I felt the presence of God. It rushed from behind me and hit this guy. And he goes, whoa, what was that? And I said, that was God. No, man, I don't believe in that. Oh, man, oh, well, what is that? So Brandon reminded me of that, and he said, not only that, but then if you were to follow up, because you knew, and you said, hey, man, your right shoulder right now, or right shoulder, is broken, and you need a healing, and God's healing it. Do you feel that? How can you dispute that? You say, man, you got something in your stomach or even a physical ailment that's immediate, could be fixed. How can you dispute that God exists if you've just been healed? So then I said, okay, so you want to be able, you want to know God so that you can know his will, his voice, you can be a willing and able to demonstrate his power and his glory as we are called to be. Amen? Because Jesus said, the things that you saw me do, you will do even the greater. And if we haven't prove that by now, but like that's not for today. It is absolutely for today. It is absolutely for today. And so to be that, then I said, so Brandon, what does it cost to know him? And I want you to think it, what does it cost to know God and Holy Spirit in that type of capacity where he is with you and you're walking every step with him and demonstrating his glory? And I'm not talking about everybody has to be a preacher with a pulpit or traveling an evangelist. I'm talking about everywhere you are. If you're a police officer in your police world, if you're a doctor in your doctor world, if you're a secretary in your secretary world, whatever position that you have, if you're an auto mechanics guy in that world, what job do you have? Sign guy, a billing collector, wherever you are, you're operating in his authority, knowing his voice all the time because you're not... Your identity is not banker. Your identity is child of God, Christ follower. And so when you operate, so what's the cost? And so then Brandon said, the cost would be just to read your Bible constantly, to pray, to fast, to be sold out to him. I was like, yeah, that sounds good. I'll accept that answer. And then I said, is it worth the cost? And you need to answer that really quick in your own self. Is it worth the cost? I love teenagers. I still feel young. I might look super old to you. Thank you, Chantel. But I still feel young. And some of the people over here like you are. So I'll take that. But young people, every person, because we type of focus on them, but every person in the room, just hear this thought. This is real. Jesus is real. Heaven and hell is real. Why waste any time? Why waste any time when he is so real? He is so real. His tricks and the devil's tricks and plans, they will divert you and try to take you off the path. But man, just be wiser, be smarter and say, devil, you are so dumb. You are so obvious. You are so foolish. Heck no, I'm not going to be doing that. Heck no, because his presence is more valuable. I know he's real. And if he's real, then I'm not going to pursue a little. I'm going to pursue with everything that he has. So is the cost worth it? Is what the cost worth his voice in your life? Is the cost worth the demonstration and the power of the Holy Spirit? Is it worth it? And then Brandon said, yes, it's worth it. So here's the last question. Then what's stopping you? Drop the mic. if he's worth it. Because you said he was, rhetorically, I heard you. If he's worth it, if the cost is worth it, then what's stopping you? What things are in the way? I mean, do those things really matter? Is it super hard to pray? Is it super hard to fast? Is it super hard to read your Bible? Is it super hard to know him? No, it is not hard to know him. He says that he calls us, he draws us. And if he's drawing you, just walk towards him because he's drawing you. He's drawing you. The cost to give up all the pleasures of sin, it's nothing. It is absolutely nothing. Well, I'm so old, I don't know if I can do it. I hate that excuse. When I used to travel and young and older people came to me and said, "Son, well, you got it. You need to go for it. I'm just too old to be out there doing anything now." No, you're not. You still have breath. You still have breath. You still have ability. Even if you're in your deathbed laying there, there is a nurse to minister to. There is a doctor to minister to. But I'm dying. So what? Heal them. But I'm... Man. If only I was a little bit younger. And the young people, if only I was older, I'd have more boldness. No, have the boldness now. Have the anointing now. Have the Holy Ghost now. Why wait? Why wait? Amen. The Bible in Romans says, never be lacking in zeal. Keep your spiritual fervor. How do you do an altar call for something like this? I don't know. I think that something like this, you take home and you chew on it and you ask yourself those questions. And I don't think you just ask yourself those questions once. See, those questions that I just asked Brandon and I asked you, I had to ask myself all of those questions. And I found that it was worth it and that there was nothing worth stopping me. And so now we're stepping forward into who we are called to be. Because there is a world that needs us. Not only is the world needs us, but there is a God that loves us and wants that type of relationship with us. It's not the relationship through the pastor to you. It's your relationship with him. Amen. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. If there's anyone in the room tonight, you need salvation. I want you to slip up your hand real quick. You're like, "God, I need salvation. I need Jesus in my life." Just slip up your hand. You're doing things that Jesus would never do and you want forgiveness. We're not going to call you to the front. Thank you. Amen. Those of you that want to draw closer to God, you can open your eyes now if you'd like to. Those of y'all that want to draw closer to God, just lift up your hand. If you want to draw closer to God, you want to know him. You want to know him and you're willing to pay that price. He's in the room. He's in the room. Father, we just pray right now over each person in this house. We thank you, God, for the drawing that I asked earlier, God, how many you've been drawing, and there were several that raised their hand. I pray, God, that you would draw all. And even if you don't, Lord, that they would begin to step forward and pursue you, because I know that you said, if you seek me, you will find me. If you knock, I will open. And so, Father God, we ask, Lord, right now as we begin to go after you, as we begin to pay the price, in quotations, as a price, if that's what we want to call it, if we begin to follow you, Lord Jesus, I pray that you'd begin to move on our behalf, that you begin to move on our hearts. In Jesus' powerful name, we thank you for it. We glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to leave you with one, I don't know, I'm going to say another thought, and if there's another one that jumps on behind it, I'm not going to say, I just got one last thing to tell you. If you take this and you move with the Holy Spirit, he will answer you. He will. He absolutely will. He will. Amen. Yes. Chantel, are you happy? 7:27? Oh, she took off. Hallelujah. How many of y'all feel the presence of the Lord in the house? He is amazing. And if you don't pretend you do. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Who needs a healing in the house this evening? Who needs a healing? Just raise your hand if you need a healing. Hallelujah. Nobody needs healings. Oh, awesome. Put your hand on her real quick. That's her birthday too, so let's give her birthday healing. All those around her, put your hand on her right there in the name of Jesus. Who else needs a healing? You do? Oh, you're stretching your hand. Hallelujah. Who else needs a healing? We want to get you prayed for and healed tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, you need a healing too? All right, put your hands over here on her healing power. Healing power right now in the name of Jesus. Come on, church, help me pray for them right now in the name of Jesus. Healing power flow through them right now. Right now, you know the need, and you are the healer. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. It is finished. It is finished. It is finished. Hallelujah. 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 If you need something else from God, we're not going to ask you what it is. If it's private, it's fine. If you need something else from God, I want you to slip your hand real quick. We got a few more minutes right here. If someone can just lay hands on these people, if you can step out of where you are, just lay hands on them. Come on, help me, church. We're a family here, right? Family. In the name of Jesus. Just raise your hand again so they know where you are. Hallelujah. Whatever the need is right now. Are you stretching your hand? Okay. Praise the Lord. Father, we just thank you right now that you are you answer every prayer. You answer every prayer. You're worthy, Father God. Meet the need right now. Meet the need right now, Jesus. In Jesus' powerful name. Meet the need. Meet the need. Meet the need. We thank you for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. You're worthy. Praise the Lord. Y'all hang out as long as you want to tonight. We're family. Yes, ma'am? She need a prayer? Okay. Someone over here. Can we just lay hands on this lady here just really quick? Hallelujah. More of your presence. More of your presence, Lord. More of your presence. Glorify. Hallelujah. Whatever she needs, you answer it. You are the God that answers prayer right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hang out as long as you want tonight. Fellowship with one another. We're family. We're going to hang out and talk and grow with each other. If there's anybody that wants anything special prayer, and we'll be willing to stay over. The prayer team will be able to stay over. If you need to go, you're dismissed. We'll see you again. I won't be here, but Sunday morning, it's going to be awesome. I want to challenge y'all to invite people with you Sunday morning. Every Sunday, keep on inviting people. And let's get this thing going. Amen. God bless you. See you soon.